wanting to continue in that country sound and really take more of the bluegrass sound.
Right.
Because they on their some of the early music, he had a lot of that banjo. But when they picked up Don Felder and certainly they picked up Joe Walsh, that's where they were going. They were going rock.
Yeah.
And so they split off. So I don't know. Apparently all those guys were going to deal with it. But
I say. But I think the coolest sound is that, you know, it's this rocker, it's this country kind of, you know, even Leonard Skinner coming along and doing it, I think that, and
good to see you all this morning. You have seen our announcements as they've been scrolling across our screens. And as always, I'd like to remind you that if you have any questions on anything that you see up there, we'd be happy to answer them through our email, which is fbcdunlap@bledsoe.net, or through you can call our church offices, and that's 949-2441. We would be happy to answer any questions for you. And just a reminder for everyone that this coming weekend, supposed to be, but it's going to last all week, is the yard sale. So next weekend, you know, there might be a lot of cars out here, but we do have plenty of parking in the gravel lot, so there will be room for everyone. So don't let the yard sale keep you away next week because you may not have a place to park, because we will, and we'll come in here and have a good time during worship. If you're a guest with us this morning, thank you for joining us. In the pocket of the chair in front of you, there is a welcome card, and what we would ask is that you take a moment to fill that out and just give us all the information listed there. We ask this so that we can follow up and get to know you better and to see how we can pray for you, which is what's on the back of that. You can give us your prayer requests, any praises that you might have. We would be happy and honored to pray for you. If you're watching with us online this morning, you can just leave us a comment or email us your prayer requests, or however we can get to know you a little bit better as well. And when you fill out the card, there are some offering plates over here in this entrance and then on our main entrance as well. Just drop that in there on your way out or during our time of offering this morning. At this time, would you please stand with me as we go to our Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you do for us, and we thank you for allowing us to gather and worship this morning. We ask that you will move in this service, Lord, and let everything that we say and do be honoring and glorifying to you. We lift your name high, and we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take a minute to greet one another.
Scripture this morning is Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and the perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Thank you, Becky. Let's raise our voices in praise this morning with hymn number 662, The Battle Belongs to the Lord. And then we'll move directly into hymn number 115, singing all four verses of God of Grace and God of Glory.
Mm-hmm. children. Oh, there they are. Come. There they are. I was thinking, oh, no, I was going to have to make Brother Richard get down here on the floor with me. Okay. That would be a trick, wouldn't it? Yeah. How are you today? Are you good? Well, I brought something for you. I bought a new shirt, and I was going to wear it today, but as you can see, it still has the price tags attached, so I decided not to. Now, I could have worn it with a price tag on it, but man, it would have itched my back all day long. It would have been. That's a good question. That's a good question. You know, I'm going to do that. It's a problem easily fixed. You just take one snip, and it's gone. How about that? How about that? The tag is not really a part of the shirt anyway. It's just on there, so the store people will know how much to charge me. But once it's mine, price tag's not. Yeah, tag's not needed anymore, is it? But like I said, I could wear it, but man, yeah, it's itchy, and then these plastic pieces and the paper, man, they would just move. I'd be back here doing this a whole time and not listen to the story. Well, that reminds me of something. You know, all we have been talking about the Israelites moving into the Promised Land and all the judges and how they don't listen. Well, God gave them instructions when they moved into the Promised Land. He said, cut off the people. Get rid of them. Get rid of their idols. Leave nothing. Like now my shirt don't have a tag on it. Well, did the Israelites listen? No. Bless their hearts. They did not listen. And those people who lived there that they didn't cut off, that they didn't get rid of, they were constantly irritating the Israelites because they was trying to get them to worship their God instead of the one true God. Not a good thing. No. No. So that got me to thinking again. Maybe we have some false gods in our lives that we need to get rid of. Maybe it's a friend who's a bad influence for us and tries to lead us down the road and set traps for us and constantly irritating us and wanting us to do things that we're not supposed to do. Or maybe it's a bad habit. You know what a bad habit is? Like biting your fingernails. Yeah, drinking too much coffee, Stevie. And, you know, things like that. So by listening to God, by cutting off these influences that are constantly irritating us, do you know what? That'll set us free, and that'll keep us from all those bad influences, from taking us down and putting us in maybe a bad place and worshiping things we're not supposed to instead of being all that God wants us to be. Wow. I want to be what God wants me to be, don't you? Let's pray about that. Anybody want to say a blessing today? Okay, I will. Dear Lord, we thank you for these children. We thank you for Jesus. And we thank you for God, though, that even though sometimes we don't listen, and man, sometimes that's a lot of days and about a lot of things, but we're so thankful, Lord, that we can come to you, ask you to forgive us, help us to do better, Lord, and point us in the way that we need to go. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all are awesome today.
Well, good morning. And let me extend the welcome that Josh and others have already extended to you this morning. We thank you for being here today. We are going to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ here this morning through song and through word and through fellowship, and we look forward to that time together. Now, our church is beginning something this week that is new for us. We have determined that we are going to pray for every household and every business in the city of Dunlap, and we start that this week. We have teams of volunteers that are going to go out during the week They are going to go to each house. They're not going to knock on the door. They're going to stand in front of the business or the home, and they're going to pray for the people inside, and they're going to leave a little something to let them know that we prayed for them. And we are going to encourage folks, when they find that little something that we've left, to go to an email address called prayingfordunlap@gmail.com and leave us their prayer requests. And we've got somebody set up that's going to be looking at that. We've got somebody that's set up to tell us where we need to go every week. And we've got the teams ready to go. And this morning, as we kick this off, the very first teams that are going to go out this week, we got two. Richard and Teresa Falkirth are going to go out, and then Diane Henry, Jimmy Bolden, and Mark Corbett are going to go out, and they're going to be praying for people. So this morning, I'd like to take just a moment before we do anything else and pray for these two teams as they go out as representatives of us to take Jesus into the community. Will you join me in prayer, please? Dear and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that we have and this privilege that we have to come together as a body of believers and worship you. Father, you are truly worthy, and we pray that we might worship you in a manner that is pleasing to you. As a part of that worship, Father, we believe that it is our duty, it is our command to take the name of Jesus Christ into our community. And to that end, we are sending out teams of people each week going forward to pray for the people in our community. So, Father, we humbly ask this day that you would be with Richard and Teresa and with Diane, Jimmy, and Mark as they go out. And Heavenly Father, that you might send the Holy Spirit out ahead of them. Father, we pray that you would allow them to be perceptive for opportunities where they might have to engage people in addition to praying for them. Heavenly Father, we do this to glorify and honor you, and we pray that you might use this, Father, to increase and grow your kingdom. We thank you for the privilege and honor we have to do this, and we pray for your blessings, Father, on these people as they go forth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now we come to a portion of our service where we have the opportunity to worship our Lord and Savior through the return to him of a portion of the blessings that he's given to us. We refer to those as tithes, sometimes offerings, but it is a time in our worship service where we want to recall all the many blessings that we have, and out of gratitude and worship to our Lord and Savior, we're going to return some of those back to him. Now, traditionally, we pass an offering plate during this time, but because of the virus that's going around, we've kind of laid off of that for a while. But we do have a number of ways that you can worship with us in this manner. You can mail us something to the address you see on your screen. You can go to our website and you can give there. Or you can take the smart device that you probably have with you this morning and do it even during this time of worship. There's a way that you can text an offering to us. You can drop by the office during the week and leave something if you wish, but we encourage you to continue to worship God in this way. This church has been very faithful during this time of uncertainty to do this, and we are so appreciative, and the community and the missions and the ministries that we support are appreciative of it as well. So at this time, I am going to ask our Deacon of the Week, Mr. Michael Reagan, to lead us in an offertory prayer, and then you're going to be blessed by the music you're going to hear this morning during the offertory. That's all I'm going to say about it. So Michael, if you would please lead us.
Thank you.
I get to follow that. I think, Dan, you need to teach all of us how to sing that. That is a great song. I appreciate it so much. And again, we're glad you're all here this morning. We're going to be continuing on in the book of Judges this morning. Judges chapter 8, starting in verse 4. If you're new to Scripture, that's not a problem. Judges is found in the Old Testament. That's the front part of the Bible. It's the seventh book in. If you turn towards Ruth, you've gone a little bit too far. And if you are in Joshua, you're just one book away. And we're going to be in the eighth chapter, starting in verse 4, going through verse 35. And we are going to build upon a story that we talked about last week. We're going to be looking at the second part of the story of Gideon. Now, for people that have been around church a lot during their life, if you say Gideon, most people kind of understand what Gideon, the story of Gideon. Except there's a whole nother part about the story of Gideon that we don't talk about very much. You know, we're familiar with the young man who was so afraid of the Midianites and so afraid of the world that the angel of the Lord found him threshing grain in the middle of a wine press. He was so scared, he was so timid, and he was so concerned with the Midianites that that's where he was trying to threat. We're familiar with that story. We're familiar with the fact that he was cautious, that he asked God on at least two occasions for reassurance. Lord, is this really what you want me to be doing? In fact, you'll hear that term today, especially around churches, where they talk about setting out a fleece. Well, that goes all the way back to Gideon, who looked at the Lord and said, Lord, if you want me to do this, you know, have the fleece be wet and the ground around it be dry. And when the Lord did that, he said, well, let's do that one more time, Lord, just to make sure, make the fleece dry and the ground around it wet. And the Lord, being the patient, wonderful, loving God that he did, worked with this young man. And he stayed with him, and finally Gideon believed him enough that he raised the army that God wanted him to raise. You see, during that time, there were these tribes of people. They were the Midianites, and we don't know a lot about them. We could probably trace where they came from and trace where they went, but the important thing about the Midianites at this time is they were described as being like locusts. And we talked about last week how locusts, if you see them portrayed, especially in Hollywood, they might be hungry enough to eat this iron podium here, okay? They ate everything in their path. They destroyed everything. So this is the way the Midianites were treating the Israelites. They were consuming everything that they had. It was to the point that the Israelites were looking for places to live in the rocks, the cracks and the crevices, and places that they could hide. It was that bad. And in the midst of this, Gideon believed the Lord enough to raise an army. And we know that story, how he raised a big army, but the Lord pared it down, and he pared it down until there was just Gideon and 300 warriors. And we talked last week about how they probably weren't the most valiant warriors because God wanted the glory for himself. They're probably 300 of the sorriest people you ever saw. And Gideon takes them into battle and ends up defeating 135,000 Midianites with 300 folks. And it's a great story, and we've heard about it. We read about it last week we saw how Gideon even gained more capability during the battle. But there's a second half to the story that we must look at today. And this is a story about forgetting your first love. It's about forgetting how you got to be where you are. So we're going to start out in verse 4 and look at the first 12 verses. And we're going to see Gideon begin to go... verses 4 through 12, not the first 12 verses. We're going to begin to see Gideon go here in a different direction. He's a little bit different mighty warrior than he was. He just completed that for which God had called him, almost. He'd met the main Midianite army in battle, and he had defeated them, but now he's mopping up. And as he's trying to mop up the remains of the Midianite army, he encounters the men of Ephraim, who were a little bit upset, so they said, because Gideon didn't call upon them to help with a main battle. So he uses them in assisting rounding up some of the remaining Midianite princes. And he's going on pursuing them. And he's showing a remarkable amount of courage when you think about it. Here, this young man, remember, he's so scared of things that he threshes in a wine press, yet his belief in God, his faith in God, his understanding of God's provision is such that he carries things through. He's now asked the men of Ephraim to help him, and they do. And in fact, he even shows a little bit of diplomacy, because now after the fact, they're a little upset that they didn't get on the main battle. You ever hear the quote by, it's attributed to Napoleon, that success has 1,000 fathers. Success has 1,000 fathers. In other words, here he'd won the battle against the Midianites, and now the Ephraimites wanted to be in on the glory. Napoleon said, success has 1,000 fathers, but defeat is an orphan. Think about that. Defeat is an orphan. And we'll see that actually come into play here just a little bit later on. Now, Gideon has done all this. He's pursuing the Midianites. There's just a few of them left. He's got a little bit work left to do. But he begins to change. You ever heard the expression, quitting while you're ahead? Anybody ever look at you and say, you better quit while you're ahead? What, all the time, somebody say? Yeah. Yeah. I've had that said to me before. You better quit while you're ahead. And how many times have I actually taken that advice? Very few. Because we get it in our heads that we can do more. You see, Gideon begins to change here. He begins to go in a different direction. He begins to rely not so much on God, but he begins to rely upon himself. We see that in what happens here. He's kind of like a great athlete. You can all probably think of a great athlete who played one season too long. The fleetness of foot of youth has departed. He doesn't have quite the hand-eye coordination he did as a younger man or as a younger woman. Plays a season too long and it's almost embarrassing. That happens. You see it in all kinds of sports. This is almost what happens to Gideon, but not quite. You see, he had a choice. He had a choice to continue on under God's wisdom, but he did not. And before we click our tongues and shake our heads and say, poor old Gideon, folks, it happens to us as well. How many times in our life are we up against it? And we know that the only person that can help us out is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we call out to Him. And He helps us. But later on, rather than quitting while we're ahead, we begin to think it's about us and not Him. We see a story of that happening here. You see, as he had enlisted Ephraim to help him, chased down the Midianite princes, he's chasing across the River Jordan after the rest of them. We don't know what happens to Ephraim. Maybe they had enough glory in chasing down the few that they helped him with. But when he crosses the Jordan, again, it's just Gideon and the 300 men. And as a good commander, Gideon knows that after a battle like that, his men need rest and water and food. So after they cross the Jordan, they go to two different cities. He goes first to the city of Sukkoth, or I don't know how you say it. I'm going to call it Sukkoth. He goes to Sukkoth, and he asks for aid. Now, the whole idea about defeat being an orphan, the men of Sukkoth looked at Gideon, and they seen he'd won a great battle, but they remember the 7 years of oppression they'd had under the Midianites, and they say, you know what, Gideon, we're not going to help you. We don't have this in Scripture, but I can almost hear what they're saying. Yeah, you've won one battle, But we put up with 7 years of this. And what happens if you eventually lose? You're going to be on your own. We're not going to be a part of that. We don't want the Midianites coming back to us and saying, will you help these guys out? So the men of Succoth turn a cold shoulder to him. So he goes next to the town of Penuel, and he goes to the leaders of Penuel, and he says, I need rest for my soldiers. I need food. I need water. And guess what the leaders of the city of Penuel told him? The very same thing. We're not going to help you. Again, we're not told why, but I think it's easy to see. They didn't want to be found on the wrong side. You know, life is like that. Sometimes you get all sorts of people on your side after you win. You look around and say, where were you when we were fighting the battle? You ever have that happen in business? Somebody come along and want to be a part of the glory, but they were not there when you were fighting in the trenches to get the job done? You see that here. It's human nature. It happens even today. You know, they just couldn't see. They didn't have any faith in God. But Gideon still, at this point, even though his attitude's starting to change, he still has enough faith in God to pursue the last few people, and he wins it. But there's a shadow over this victory. He wins. He chases down, I think there were like 15,000 of them. He chases them down. He defeats them. He captures all their leaders. And then he returns to Penuel and Succoth. And we see that this difference in attitude that he's beginning to have forces him to go into a different direction. Look at verses 13 through 21. They had denied him aid. He comes back. And if you'll recall, we didn't read it, but if you read those early verses there, he talked about disciplining the men of Succoth with thorns and thistles. His leadership style has changed. Do you not see this? His direction and his attitude are now different. He's won the battle. Have you ever heard about being a good winner, where you're gracious and you're magnanimous in victory and you have gratitude that it's won? The Lord has seen him win this great victory. The Lord has stood by him, but yet he remembers that these people did not help him. So upon his return from battle, he captures a young man of Succoth, and he persuades him to tell him the name of the leaders. Now, we're not told how he persuades the young man to give him the names, but I can't imagine that they sit down and had coffee and donuts and discussed it. I imagine he did something to this young man in order to force him to give out the names of the leaders. And he disciplines them with thorns and thistles. Now, I don't know about y'all. When you look at this, you say, well, how bad could that have been? I grew up hunting quail when I was young. Went with my dad and my uncles, and we hunted through thick and thin. And let me tell you, the Lord has created thorns and thistles, briars that will cut through denim like it's not there and will cut through two layers of reinforced khaki and cut your skin. And it's a plant that God has made. I have seen some thorns that will actually puncture a tractor tire out on the farm, okay? So when he disciplined them with thorns and thistles, don't think they got a light tap on the back. This was agony for them. And there's some poison on the end of some of these thorns and thistles. This is the man whose God's grace had taken him from a scared young man to a victorious army, and his attitude is now changed because he's thinking more of his own wisdom and his own capability here rather than the Lord. And he said, you offended me when I needed your help, so I'm going to offend you now that I have the capability to do it. He further keeps his promise to tear down the tower at Penuel. Now, we don't know what this tower was. We don't know why it was there. Very likely it could have been in the worship of another god. But he comes back and he keeps his word and he tears down the tower of Penuel and he kills some of the people there. This, I'll keep repeating this, this is the young man that God had shown on more than one occasion in his timidity that he was with him, and he does this. He chose to kill rather than forgive. Remind you of a parable that Jesus told one time about a man who the king had forgiven him his debt, and he goes away a free man but sees somebody that owes him money and threatens to turn him into the authorities. You know, we look at this sort of thing and think, okay, that was then, this is now. Guys, we're no different. That's the value of this story. You see, we see the final change in attitude on Gideon and how he dealt with his own family. At the very end of the battle, when they've got the last Midianites cornered, this is before he dealt with Penuel and Sukkoth, he takes his son and he lines up a couple of the princes of Midian that he has cornered, and he hands him his sword and he said, "Son, kill these men." Now, the language in the Hebrew tells us that his son was probably no more than 10 or 11. They use a different term for somebody that's of the age to be considered a man. This was somebody younger than that considered to be a man. Let's just say he's 10 years old. Here's a man who started out so timid that he threshed in a wine press, hands his sword to his 10-year-old son, and says, "Slaughter these men in cold blood." Well, to his son's credit, his son can't do it. But you see finally there the change in attitude that had come about Gideon. He no longer remembered who he had been. He no longer remembered God's grace to him as a young man. And as a result, he becomes a very different ruler. If you look at verses 22 through 32, we see where this goes. We see the ultimate outcome of this, because the people, upon his return, credit Gideon 100% with the victory over the Midianites. And Gideon does not correct them. They give all the praise to Gideon. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? And you say, why do we? Well, we're talking about the Israelites then. No, I'm talking about us. Why do we do that? Why do we, when we are up against it, and we've all been there, when the only thing we think we have left is the greatest thing that we have left, and that is prayer, and we pray to God, say, "God, pay attention to my situation, whatever it is, and help me out," and God does a miracle in our life. It may be a miracle of healing, may be a miracle with relationships, it may be a miracle at work. I don't know what kind of thing it is, but God restores us. God takes care of our situation, and when we get through, we heave a sigh and say, "Well, I made it through that. I made it through that." You see, we're not told this, but I firmly believe that standing behind Gideon on that day when the nation of Israel credited him with a victory, Satan stands whispering in his ear, "Gideon, you done a good job. Gideon, you did well. Gideon, if it hadn't been for you, these people would still be hiding out the rocks and the caves." You see, it's that five-letter word that the snake used in the garden to begin with, and that's to appeal to our pride, that five-letter word, pride. You can almost hear Satan whispering in Gideon's ear, "Man, you're the best. You used to be so scared, but look how you've developed yourself. Look at the steps you've taken in your life to take care of yourself. Look at what you've done. Look at the achievements that you have reached. Look at how you've handled this. Look at all these good things you've done." And you can almost see Gideon saying, "Yep, me and the old 300, we got her done. We took care of business, me and the 300. And you know what? If it hadn't been for me, actually, God really sorted it down to a bunch of sorry guys, and it was me that did most of this." You don't hear Gideon say that, but his silence at this point is deafening when he does not give God the glory. Now, somewhat to his credit, the people go even further. They say, "Gideon," in so many words, they say, "We want you to rule over us, and we want your sons and your grandsons to rule over us as well." Now, what that says in practical language is, we want you to be our hereditary king, and we want the line of Gideon to be kings over us far into the future. Now, to give Gideon just a little bit of a credit, he says at this point, "Well, God should be the one to rule, not me." But that's all he says. And he says that, but his actions belie what he really feels, because he then asks, instead of a kingship, he said, well, rather than make me king, how about you give me some gold? Okay. What does he do with this gold? Now, here's where it really begin to see the heart of Gideon. And even though his mouth is saying, I don't want to be king, his actions are saying yes, because he says, and he does, makes this gold into an ephod. Now, what an ephod was a type of garment that the priests wore during that time when they went to inquire of God. They would cast these things that were like a lot or dice called the Urim and the Thummim, and they would put this ephod on. So it was a garment. It was either made of solid material or it was woven. Gold can be spun and woven. Or it could have been made into solid plates, into an ephod. We don't know which, but we know this for sure. It would have been so heavy, it would have taken a pretty stout individual to have worn it and done anything. It was not practical for the purpose it was being made. No, it was practical for the purpose that Gideon had in mind, because he set it up in his hometown, and he set it up to where people could come and observe it, and before too long, they began to worship the ephod. We know that Gideon never had any intent of it being used for its real purpose, because there's nothing in Scripture that tells us that either Gideon or a Levite or any priest inquired of the Lord wearing the ephod. Instead, we are told that it was set up in his hometown and it became an object of worship for the people of the nation of Israel. Whose ephod is that? Oh, that's Gideon's ephod. And they began to worship it, and by connection, they began to worship and venerate Gideon himself. Now, they worshiped it. And that should remind us, folks, this is somewhat repetitive. It may sound a little bit funny, but we should always remember that the main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. And what is the main thing? The main thing is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the good news that he brought to this earth, that we can have a relationship with our Heavenly Father through him. That is the main thing. Everything that we do should flow from that. Nothing we should do, should we do it, and then say, let's see if we can nail the gospel on top of it. It should all flow from the good news of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that we should repent of our sins, confess them to him, and place our faith and trust in him. That is the main thing. Everything else that we do should flow from that. Our physical elements of worship, our ministries, everything that we do. Yes, they're important, but they should be focused and grounded upon the Word of God, specifically the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are under commission by him to make disciples as we go about life. We are to make disciples of Jesus Christ who tell other people about the gospel. It's the only thing that matters. Everything else, including me, including you, brother and sister, is secondary to the proclamation of the good news of Jesus Christ. So here we have Gideon, this timid man, who through God's reassurance did mighty things, but then through a changing attitude and a changing direction, becomes a different kind of ruler, one that is focused upon himself and not God. And after 40 years of peace under Gideon, we see his legacy. And his legacy is not what we think. You see, we're told in the last verses of chapter 8 that Gideon had a son by a slave girl. Again, that tells us that he fell into the same trap as other leaders did during that time and took more than one wife. And we're not even sure the slave girl is his wife, because she's mentioned as a slave girl, not as a wife, not even as a concubine. So we're not sure who she was, other than somebody Gideon decided that he needed more than she needed to be herself. He treated her as an object. I got a whole nother sermon coming about that down the road, okay? So just hang on. And he and this slave girl have a child. This child they name Abimelech, which in the Hebrew means the son of the king. So if you had any doubts about how Gideon really thought of himself, Abimelech, the name tells us, the son of the king. And we'll hear more about Abimelech as we go on. But when Gideon passes, the people immediately return to their worship of the Baals and the Asherahs. Why? I think because they've been worshiping Gideon and his ephod. And they turned to another graven image, and that was the Baals and the Asherahs. They turned away from that, even after 40 years of peace, even after understanding maybe that this was from God, they turn away from him again. And they forget Gideon, and they treat his family poorly. Now, what can we learn from this? What is important for us today to know about this? What can we learn from Gideon? Well, I think there's a number of things. First, it can happen to us. As I said earlier, all of us have been through things in our life. And most of us, I pray, are born-again believers. And when we've passed through these dark times, we've relied upon our Lord and Savior to see us through. But I call to your attention 1 Corinthians, Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, the first one that we have, chapter 10, verse 12, where Paul looks them square in the eye and says, "So whoever thinks he stands must be careful not to fall." So as we look at these old Israelites, as we look at Gideon in particular, and say, "My, how could he have done that?" We must hear these words in our ear, not Satan whispering to us, but the Apostle Paul saying, "You better be careful. Because where you think you are the strongest, you should be careful not to fall there." How many people have we known during our lives that said, "Hey, I've got this area of my life taken care of. I'm rock solid with the Lord here. I've got some issues over here I need to work on, but I'm rock solid here." And we get to paying attention to this and forget about how it's only our Lord and Savior that keeps us rock solid here. And before we know it, while we're looking at this, we have a problem over here. It happens all the time. You read about people, especially people that are noteworthy, who they think, "How could this happen to them?" Well, they thought they could stand, but instead that they fell. It can happen to every one of us. Why can it happen to every one of us? The second thing we can learn about Gideon is this, and it's tied to making sure that we don't fall. We are all tempted, especially those of us who've repented of our sins and received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We are tempted. Why? Because a couple of reasons. Because it builds our character if we let it, but probably equally as well, Satan wants to tempt us. He knows he can't have us because we're safe in the palm of our Lord and Savior's hand, but he wants to destroy our witness. He will tempt us to where we fall, so our witness is destroyed. That's what Satan wants to do. Just in the next verse, there in 1 Corinthians 10, listen to what Paul says. It says, "No temptation has come upon you except what is common to humanity. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation he will also provide a way out so that you may be able to bear it." Notice Paul doesn't say, "If you are tempted." He says, "When you are tempted." Folks, it comes to all of us. If it came to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which it did, how could we think we can never be tempted? Because we will be tempted. But we have this assurance. We have this hope. It's given to us right here. "But with the temptation, he will also provide" what? "A way out so that you may be able to bear it." Gideon always had a way out. Gideon always had that experience. He always had that understanding that the Lord had been with him. He always had a way out. We always know that Jesus has told us time and time again, "I am with you always." He's been given authority over all things in heaven, all things in earth. He is with us always. Any temptation that we're given, the Lord will give us a way out if we can but remember to do it. We are not so strong that we can turn away temptation on our own. And that's what happened to Gideon. When he was tempted, he turned to himself. When we are tempted, we must turn to Jesus Christ. Finally, we should never idolize leaders in our faith community. I know we love and respect our Sunday school teachers, our deacons, our denominational leaders, leaders in the church. But you know what? Any leader in a church is just a member of the flock. I'm nothing but a member of the flock. I'm a dirty, stinking old sheep, just like the rest of you, okay? I've just been called to a different accountability. We're all a part of the flock. We should never raise people up on idle blocks. We should never lift them up. We should never worship their ephod, if you will, because we're just all sheep trying to make our way. Listen to what Becky read to us early. I'm going to read it again before we started. Therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, a large cloud of people, that's people with us, people who have gone before us, who have met this temptation, who have not forgotten who their Lord and Savior is, who have met this temptation and stand as witnesses before us that they can make it through life, through the storms of life, through everything that happens and remain faithful and true to Jesus Christ. We are surrounded by a cloud of those people. Let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. The writer of Hebrews is exhorting the people he's writing to, lay this sin aside. You've got examples. You've got the Lord with you. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus Christ, the source and perfecter of our faith. We keep the main thing, the main thing. That's the main thing to do, is to keep our eyes on Christ. And he's telling us here, keep our eyes on Christ, the source and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Our Lord and Savior and God sit side by side. And if we need his assistance, he is there to grant it to us if we can remember to rely upon him, keep him the main thing, and not ourselves. That's what we can learn from Gideon this morning, is not to take our eyes off of Jesus Christ. And you say, well, that was then, and this is now, and times are different. Not so much different. If you look at Revelation chapter 2, all that way from Judges to Revelation, listen to Revelation chapter 2, verse 4, in Jesus speaking to the church at Ephesus, that wonderful church, the letter to it from Paul that we have that we call Ephesians, and all of the wonderful things he had to say about the Ephesians, this is what Jesus had to say about them later on. He said, but I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. And that love is Jesus Christ. Gideon was tempted and he failed after all God had done for him. The church at Ephesus had forgotten what Christ had done for them. They forgot their first love. What about us this morning? Have we forgotten the love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Have we walked through the fire only to turn around and congratulate ourselves on being great firemen? Or do we understand that it's only the protecting hand of our Lord and Savior that saw us through? I don't know how the Holy Spirit may have touched you this morning. I trust that the Holy Spirit is always working, regardless of who may be speaking or preaching God's word. So I know the Holy Spirit is working in your heart. Let me encourage you, if you've gotten to that point in life where you're pretty proud of yourself, where you think that you have done this on your own, let me encourage you to understand that it's only the actions of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that have done this. Maybe you have never repented of your sins. Maybe all this sounds different to you. The good news is, and the hope that we have, is that he always stands with his arms open wide saying, repent of your sins. Now is the time. Place your faith and trust in me and be saved. And for those of you that have done this, maybe you've been living on your own. Maybe you've been happy of how good a job you've done. And maybe the Holy Spirit has touched you this morning to remind you that it's not you, it's him. Maybe you need to confess that. Maybe you need to join this church. Maybe you need to be baptized. I don't know what the Holy Spirit is laying on your heart, but I know this. I know the Holy Spirit is active among you this morning. Will you stand at this time with me, please? Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your love, and Father, we thank you for seeing us through hard times. So, Father, we humbly ask this morning that we might acknowledge the working of the Holy Spirit in us. Father, that we might acknowledge that it is you and not us that has brought us thus far. And Father, I pray for anyone here who needs to take action on the basis of the Holy Spirit working in them, that they might have the courage and boldness through your action to do that this morning. In Jesus' name we pray it, Father. Amen.
Let's sing hymn number 533, Set My Soul Afire.
Morning. Thank you for your attention. I would encourage you to come back tonight at 6 o'clock. We will be studying an account in Scripture and talking about how it impacts our lives. This coming Wednesday night is our August business meeting, so I would encourage you to be a part of that. Continue to be in prayer for our teams that are going to be going out this week into the community. And we look forward to seeing you back soon. If I could take just a moment of personal privilege here, it was 4 years ago, the first Sunday in August, that Dee and I came to be a part of this family. And we appreciate so much the way you all have welcomed us in and opened your arms and loved us. It's been an eventful 4 years. And I look forward to as many more as you all will put up with us. And the Lord has us to work here. Okay, one of your members told me one time that once we got the building paid off, that's when they'd run us off. So you just take that however you want to, okay? Now, if I see a big jump in building funds being given, then I'll know what that meant, okay? But in all seriousness, we very much appreciate being part of what you do here. You have a wonderful staff of people that are here. You have a wonderful church family, and we're just so humbled and privileged to be a part of it. Thank you so much. So, Dan, how are we going to leave today?